So what does tiger poop smell like?
To me, like dairy milk.
What?
I know this was an unexpected answer, but it is true. I shouldn't say dairy milk. It's basically like some milk chocolate smell.
That's Dr. Arjun Srivathsa. As a scientist who studies wildlife in India, Arjun is often sniffing poop. Poop of tigers, leopards, wild dogs, and so on. This is an important skill to have, he says, if you want to be a wildlife scientist who dreams of saving threatened species here. So, just like you have professional wine tasters, I would call Arjun a professional poop sniffer.
Yeah, I think I should list it down on my CV. So right now it's not there, but I'm realizing that I have more expertise on this than I realized.
Welcome to Imagined Tomorrow. This is the show that imagines futures for India. Futures that could become a reality when science and tech try to solve problems within our uniquely Indian context. I'm your host, Shreya. This episode is an Imagined Tomorrow short, where we take a detour to discuss an idea sparked by a future we previously explored. Last episode, we wondered what might happen if we have governments and scientists monitoring sewage or our collective poop and pee in cities. If you haven't already, do check out that episode. This time, we'll go into a world where poop surveillance is quite common. The world of animals. Wildlife in particular. And in this wild world, there are a bunch of people who have spent decades searching for, then closely examining feces. So, why are scientists so interested in wildlife poop? And can it be good for the future of India's threatened species? To find out, let's follow Arjun's life a little. It revolves a lot around poop because he studies a rather secretive and elusive animal that most people would have rarely seen. Dholes, or the Asian wild dog. This species is related to the dogs we know, but they sound more like a bird and look like a long-legged fox.
They look sort of reddish-brown in color. They have fluffy black tails. They live in groups called packs. The packs can have anywhere from 2 to 3 individuals or up to about 20 to 25 individuals. They weigh about 15 to 20 kilos, so they're not very big animals. But and then packs of dholes can together hunt down really large prey like spotted deer or sambar or even gaur, which weigh like 20, 30 to 50 times their body weight.
Despite living in groups and doing some very coordinated takedowns, dholes are very hard to spot in our forests. One, because they are just super rare. Two, because like other carnivores, they prefer to slink around rather than announce their presence. If you've ever been on a wildlife safari, you would know that spotting a carnivore like a tiger, a leopard, or a jungle cat is just sheer luck.
You may see like some of these tigers that frequent the tourism zones in some of the protected areas and parks in India more frequently. But by and large, leopards, tigers, dholes, they're all like very secretive animals. So if you want to survey really large landscapes to figure out where they're found and where they're not, it's impossible to do that if we just rely on direct sightings of these animals.
So what do you do when you can't see something or someone? You follow signs that they leave behind. In the case of humans, it's things like fingerprints and hair, or even sewage, as we learned in the last episode. It's not very different with animals. You track their footprints or paw prints and hair, or you try to find their poop.
All of the species that typically inhabit the forests of India, they all have a fairly distinct poop, either the way they look, the way they're deposited, the location where they're deposited, the size, the smell, and so on.
We humans like to keep our excretions hidden away from public view. But many animals poop publicly, in strategic places, because they want other animals to know that they are around.
The poop contains a lot of information, so it's chemical signaling. So they let other individuals know that this is my territory, or if they're sexually available and so on. So it needs to be in a location that is easily detectable by other individuals of their own species. So typically it's not like hidden somewhere. It's very obviously deposited on the tracks.
So poop itself isn't that hard to find. What is tricky is to be able to say that this piece of poop belongs to a tiger or that one was left behind by a dhole. But scientists like Arjun have their ways of finding out.
If you see large cats like tigers and leopards, they typically scrape the ground a little bit and poop, and then sometimes also try to cover it up a little bit again. So you'll see like a scrape mark with the grass that's been depressed, or like the ground that's been scratched out, and then you'll find a little bit of poop. But dholes don't do that because they also poop together when they're moving around. So you'll see like this huge pile of poop in like bits and pieces across the road for quite a distance, 10 to 20 meters from where you're standing. So these are the different things that you use to figure out whether it's one or the other. But you never know. Sometimes you'll just have like this one piece of one dhole in the bag that decided to poop. And like if it also decided to just like cover it up a little bit, you know, different things can happen. So that makes it a bit of like a playing the detective also sometimes in the field.
And just like detectives, people like Arjun have to rely on as many poop IDing skills as possible, like smell. Remember in the beginning, Arjun said that to him, tiger poop smells like milk chocolate?
I'll give a disclaimer. All shits stink. You're trying to like figure out that one or two notes that sort of distinguish one from the other.
Some notes are just awful, like the poop of a domestic dog, which Arjun says just smells like shit. The poop of a dhole, on the other hand, reminds him of a beautiful wet dog.
If you have a dog, you know, if it's playing around in the rain and it comes back, there is a smell. It's not a great smell, but it's not that much of a stench either.
And just like poop of different animals have distinct smells, so does their pee.
So there's a lot of things that people have said about even tiger pee, for example, that it smells like butter, popcorn or basmati rice and so on.
And some of his colleagues are trying to figure out the science behind this. They're trying to find out what molecules in the pee of a tiger trigger memories of buttered popcorn in some people and basmati rice in others.
I'm in the latter crowd, just in case you were wondering. It smells like basmati rice to me. So much so that when I'm walking past a South Indian restaurant sometime and I get a whiff in the middle of Bangalore and immediately I think of a tiger.
The reason scientists go to such lengths to understand what animal a poop has come from is because animal poop, like human poop, is a goldmine of information. For example, it can tell scientists what the animals actually eat in the wild. Some animal poop could be full of seeds, meaning the animal eats fruits or berries. Some poop might contain bones, tiny bits of hooves, and fur or hair, which can then tell scientists what specific species these animals have been eating.
So the thing is, when carnivores eat food, the hair of their prey species is not digested. That just gets passed on into the poop. So we examine those hairs to sort of figure out what they may have eaten. So from a chunk of poop, you take a bunch of hair, and then you put it under the microscope one at a time. And each animal's hair is also different. And based on that, we can also determine not just what they've eaten, but also use some statistical models to figure out how many and how much they've eaten.
Like whether dholes are eating more spotted deer or barking deer, or perhaps they are not getting enough food in the forest, and so they've been heading to a nearby village to hunt goats. All this poop is precious for another reason, because it contains the animal's DNA, a lot of it. And this DNA can tell scientists two big things. One, that they've got the species right, that it's indeed the poop of a dhole or a tiger, just as they had suspected. Two, it can also tell them which individual the poop belongs to.
The problem with dholes is that they're endangered species, and one of the most important metrics we need in order to know how to conserve or manage endangered species is to know how many of them there are, how many dholes there are in the world. We can say things like, oh, we have not seen them in a while, so populations are declining and so on, but we actually need hard numbers. To do that, we need to be able to identify individuals.
With species like tigers and leopards, that's a little bit easier to do because each individual tiger has a unique pattern of stripes and each individual leopard has a unique pattern of spots. So while these animals are also secretive, you can set up cameras in forests that operate remotely. And when a tiger or leopard passes by, these cameras get triggered to take pictures. You can later match the patterns in these pictures to individual animals.
But all dholes pretty much look the same, so we can't use camera traps directly and identify individuals. So one of the things that I really wanted to do was to come up with the field methods as well as the lab methods together that can help us identify individual dholes and therefore count them, not based on photographs, but using their poop.
Arjun has recently finished one poop-based IDing exercise in Wayanad Tiger Reserve in Kerala, and he's found that there are some 50-odd individual dholes there. This is in fact one of the first reliable estimates of dhole populations in India, all from poop. But to my disappointment, they don't have nice traditional Indian names.
I want to name them like Manjunath and Suresh and Pankaja and things like that. But the idea is not that you do this just once, but you have to have a record of these individuals across time. So if I go back to Wayanad and do the survey again, I need to be able to match that individual if I got it captured again in the year after or 2 years later and so on. So we give them, unfortunately, like in the lab, they're all given very boring names like DHL1, DHL2 and so on.
Think of the IDs as the animal's unique Aadhaar numbers. There might be multiple Manjunaths, but only one DHL10 and only one DHL23. This allows Arjun and others to track each dhole individually. Not just that, the DNA and this IDing exercise can help scientists build entire family trees and track all family members of very threatened species.
Yeah, so one of the other things that we can do with the DNA from the poop is basically try to figure out if the two individuals that gave us the two samples, if they're related, and we can figure out if they're siblings or unrelated or if they're mother, daughter, and so on. And what would be interesting for me for studying dholes is that because they're social animals that live in groups, to see how related are individuals within a group and how that changes across packs, inside protected areas, across protected areas, and so on. So these sort of things can also help us sort of figure out, like, you know, whether there's like connectivity in the landscape and, you know, how do individuals move up and down and things like that.
Imagine a Game of Thrones saga, but with dholes. There are a lot of other questions that poop can answer. For example, poop can reveal how well the animals are doing, like whether they are stressed or not. That's because scientists can check for levels of stress-related hormones in poop. Scientists can also see if an animal is carrying a disease by checking its feces. Again, it's because microbes from within the body often end up in excretions. People have also used poop to catch poachers. Take elephants, for example. Both elephant dung and their tusks contain the animal's DNA. And using dung DNA, scientists have created population maps of elephants across Africa. So when there's an illegal ivory cargo somewhere, they can match the DNA from the ivory to the area it probably came from. In short, poop surveillance is helping scientists and governments understand the wild world a little bit better. All of this obviously sounds like good news, but it also makes me wonder. On one hand, we are losing our wild heritage because we don't pay enough attention to it. On the other hand, many species that are threatened are under some kind of surveillance. Cameras, drones, radio collars, poop. But like us, do animals also need privacy?
So that's an interesting question to sort of think about. I haven't viewed that from the angle of animal privacy in terms of are they trying to hide. Remember, I spoke some time back about how they want the other individuals and the species to know what they're trying to signal through their poop. So the poop itself is not like a secretive thing. So it's a way of signaling for them. And also, we're not like revealing the identities to anybody. Like even with the published stuff, the things that we've published in scientific papers, nobody knows who DHL001 is. So the identity that way is like still pretty secure. We'll just know if we have found that same individual the next year or not.
If we keep the question of privacy aside for a moment, animal poop surveillance opens doors to a deeper understanding of our wild heritage, something we probably wouldn't have imagined before. And Arjun hopes to pass on his poop wisdom to others, so they too can help secure the future of our species.
You know, once you get into the science of it, you understand why, but to just sit and explain to my family, for example, when they say, what do you do in the forest besides just like walking for 15 kilometers a day? And if I tell them that my entire job is to look for animal shit and collect it, I don't know how they perceive that. But that makes it very fascinating to me that we are doing cutting edge science, but it's all shit.
Imagined Tomorrow is created and hosted by me, Shreya Dasgupta. Abhijit Shylanath is the man behind the theme music, sound design, mixing, and editing. Thanks to Arjun for sharing his animal poop wisdom with us, and to Abhishek Madan for being a patient listener of multiple drafts. If you liked this episode and would like to support us, do give us a shout out on social media and share it with your friends and family to get the word out. Our email is imaginedtomorrow@gmail.com. You can also say hi to me on Twitter @ShreyaDasGupta. Follow us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen to podcasts. That's it for today. See you soon.